Hi, this is Professor Kleitz, and in the next two sections I'm going to talk about semiconductor switches, most likely the diode and a transistor. Manual switches and electromechanical relays have limited use in today's high-speed digital electronic circuits. So what we need to do is come up with some semiconductor technology which uses diodes and transistors to do our switching for us. In Chapter 9, we'll get into a lot more detail on forming TTL and CMOS integrated circuits using transistors and diodes. But for now, we're basically going to look at the diode and the transistor is on-off type switches. In Figure 22, I show that a diode is a two-terminal device. It has an anode and a cathode, and when you try to force conventional current through the anode into the cathode, it does flow. This is a one-way device because when you try to send current, you see I flipped the battery upside down? When I send the current this way, conventional current will not go into the cathode, so this blocks the current in that direction. And these two diagrams, this is called a reverse bias diode and this is called a forward bias diode. In Figure 23, I show the analogy with a water system check valve. This is a hinged valve inside a tube and we're trying to get water to flow through this. And you can imagine if this was hinged, when you try to push water this way, it will flow. But if you try to reverse the flow and push it this way, I don't know if you can quite see, but there's a little bit of an angle on this lip down here and it gets caught and it cannot go. This is otherwise known as a check valve. It does take a little bit of pressure to get this valve to open. In the case of a diode, which we'll see in just a minute, it takes 0.7 volts and there'll be a 0.7 volt loss just to get this flapper to open. And that's what shows up in the characteristic curve in Figure 24. As you apply more and more of a forward voltage, that means putting a positive voltage toward the anode, no current flows until you overcome a 0.7 volt barrier potential. And after that, current does start flowing. So as you increase the voltage further and further, there will be a forward current flow. And this graph also shows it in the reverse direction when you put a negative voltage on the anode. By putting a positive on the cathode, you get no current. I kind of show here is a little bit of leakage current and that is undesirable, but they're basically we just assume that it's going to not allow current to flow in the reverse direction. So as I said, and what I'll show you in Figure 25 is when you forward bias this diode, there will be a 0.7 volt drop. It acts like an ideal diode internally, but it will lose 0.7 volts. So if you start with 5, you'll end up with only 4.3 by the time you make it out to your load resistor, the 1K resistor. The amount of current that flows could be calculated by using Ohm's law, voltage over resistance. And so the current is equal to the 5 minus the drop divided by a 1K resistor that we have. That gives us 4.3 milliamps. Typically diodes operate anywhere from 4 or 5 milliamps up through maybe 50 to 100 milliamps is where we like to keep them. So for an example, let's look at example 2-9 and see whether these are forward biased or reverse biased. In this case, the 5 volts is trying to send current in the right direction. This will be forward biased. Could you guess what the voltage would be of V1? Well, if you start with 5, you're going to lose 0.7, that'll be 4.3. In this case, is this reverse biased? I think so. You're trying to send current down, it's not going to go. Now, if this is reverse biased, how many volts would you see at V2? Well, there's no current through a 1K, 0 amps times 1K is 0 volts across this resistor means V2 is 0. How about this circuit for V3? Is this forward biased? Yeah, we're sending current in the right direction down toward ground. Do you think V3 will also be 4.3? No. 5 over here is going to send current through a forward biased diode. Now, when the diode's forward biased, it acts like an ideal switch with a 0.7 volt drop across it. So the voltage from anode to cathode is 0.7. That means V3 is 0.7. How about this circuit? Is this reverse biased? Yes, it is. You can't send current down through the cathode. What do you think V4 would be then? You think it would be 0 or 5? The answer is 5, because there's no current flow, there's no voltage drop across the 1K. You start with 5 here, you drop nothing, you're left with 5 out here. So V4 is going to be 5 volts in this case. You could try any of these circuits in lab and you'll match up pretty close to what we just said. And finally, the last two circuits, with determine V5, you have to look at both of these diodes. This one with 0 volts on here is trying to, it's facing 0 down here because ground is 0. There's no difference of potential. There will be no current flow through this D6 diode. Therefore, I would call that reverse biased. However, D5 does have the positive on the anode. This will be forward. It'll lose 0.7, leaving us with 4.3 out here. This circuit, we're providing a ground. Now, 0 is the same as ground. So we're providing a ground path right where my pen is toward the 0 down into ground. So the 5 volts will send current down through here, through D7 into the 0 volt ground. The 5 volt will try to send current here, but there's no difference in potential. You got 5 on this side, 5 on the cathode side. There'll be no current, so D8 is reverse biased. So D7 is forward bias. So what's V6 going to be? Do you think it's going to be 4.3? 5? 0.7? 0.7 is the answer, because this is forward bias. Remember, you're measuring from this point to ground, which is the same as measuring right across the diode, because here's ground over here. You'll be measuring 0.7 at V6. So go back and review these. The explanation is also included in the textbook right under figure 26. And make sure you have this under your belt before you try the homework problems. Okay, in section 8 we're going to talk about transistors. And there's two types of transistors, an NPN and a PNP. We'll be using both throughout the book, but mostly in this section I want to talk about just the NPNs. They're made out of, it's a three-terminal device. It's going to have an N channel made out of silicon, and then it's going to have a P channel in the middle called the base, and then it's going to have another N channel called the collector. So it'll end up being emitter, base, and collector. So in figure 27 we have the physical layout, NPN, collector, base, emitter, as well as the schematic diagram, collector, base, emitter. Current is going to be trying to go down through from the collector down into the emitter to ground, and it will be allowed to pass if you forward bias the base by putting a positive voltage on it. And we'll take a look at that in just a minute. Here's the relative size of a transistor. This says 2N3906, which is a PNP, 2N3904, which is an NPN type. So any positive voltage above maybe 1 volt or so is going to produce enough current through the base emitter to forward bias this base emitter junction, which internally is just like a diode. So if this is forward biased, what happens is the transistor turns on. This is the term we use to define the transistor when the collector to emitter is a short circuit. Now, a short circuit means that C is connected directly to E, which means we'll have 0 volts out, because if you're out here and you look in, you're connected right to ground. The current will flow from the 5 volts down through the RC resistor into ground, but the voltage measured at the output would be 0 in this case. On the other hand, if you put 0 on the base, you're not forward biasing the base emitter. Transistor is considered off. It has an open circuit collector to emitter. Now, if you want a review of shorts and opens, make sure you look at Appendix F. I talk about that in that section. So if this is an open circuit from C to E, you can kind of just erase this, take it right off the page. You've got 5 volts connected directly to the output because there's no current flow. It has nowhere to go. You have 5 volts here. No current creates no voltage drop. I times RC. I times R is 0. 5 minus 0 is still 5. So when the transistor's off, you get 5 out in this particular circuit. In example 2-11, we'll use a timing waveform analysis to determine the comparison between the input clock pulse and the output. So in this case, we're going to use a clock pulse to drive the base emitter junction of this transistor. And as you can imagine, when the clock pulse goes plus 5 or positive, it's going to forward bias the base emitter, making a short from collector to emitter. So when this is positive, which I show here in the waveforms for the clock pulse, when it's plus 5, that's going to turn on the transistor. This is a short, and V out will be connected directly to the emitter or ground, so V out will be 0. So when this is high, the output is 0. Then when the clock pulse is low, 0, which is right here, when it's low, the transistor will be off, and as we described earlier, there'll be no current flow down through the circuit, so 5 volts minus IR drop, minus the IR drop, will be still 5 volts. So 5 volts minus no drop gives you 5 volts at the output. So when the input is 0, the output's 5, and that's what I'm showing here. The input is 0, the output's 5. This shows up as an inverter circuit because you get the exact opposite waveform at the output that you came in at the input at. When this is low, the output's high. When the input is high, the output is low. And so the explanation is at the bottom of the example. Make sure you read this just to reaffirm everything that I just said. And example 2-12 is explained in the textbook also, but I'll go through this briefly. Here we've got the clock applying the pulses to 0505. When the transistor is turned on, the V out is connected directly to ground. So right here, when this is high, you got a 0 out. But where did I get the 4.76 from? This is the voltage divider equation, because when this is off, think about where the current's going to flow. Here's the 5 volts is going to send current down through the 1K, over here and down through a 20K. You have to use the voltage divider equation to calculate V out for that instance, which is 4.76. So read the explanation lower in this example. So this concludes these two sections. First of all, the diodes, and then the transistors and switches. Next, we're going to look at forming TTL circuits and inverters using transistors.